Are you natural? Do you take steroids?
All the time.
I have to ask the question for the people. Yeah. What's your thoughts on this topic? Are you natural? What would be your best advice for growing a social media following? Oh, here we go. We're on YouTube.
Awesome. Should I square up first?
How are we facing each other?
Okay, yeah, like an angle.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Sweet. What's going on, everyone? Daniel Vadnell here for Fitness FAQs. I'm here with
Austin Dunham. What's up, guys?
So this is episode number 2 of Fitness FAQs World. Wanted to sit down with Austin, ask him a few questions, get to know him a little bit further, and just get his history, his philosophy behind training, and much, much more.
Yeah, let's do it, man. Excited.
Awesome. It's good to have you here, man.
Of course. I've been watching you forever, like I've said a million times by now, so it's pretty awesome to be on the channel and discuss more things with you. So let's do it.
Sounds good, man. So just to start with, when did you first start training? What's your history and what's your story?
Gotcha. So I first started training September 1st, 2014. And I know that date exactly because that was the date that I decided to just put everything else down and go full on with my calisthenics and fitness journey. And so I joined what's called the Air Force ROTC program, which is a military program where you join to eventually join the Air Force. And within that program, we have military fitness tests. So every month we had to do a set of push-ups, a set of sit-ups, and a mile and a half run. And we also had PT or physical training 3 times a week in the morning. And I remember going to my first PT session and just being completely out of shape. After that, I was like, I'm gonna figure out how to perform the most amount of push-ups in the least amount of time and just get better.
Yes.
So I started on Google, how to get better at push-ups.
Yeah.
One of your videos probably popped up.
Yeah, man.
I don't know. But from there, I came across some YouTube tutorials and stuff like that. And I discovered like these transformation videos. Yeah. And then I came across some calisthenics transformation videos. And I was like, what is calisthenics training? I never heard of this style of training, but I watched some transformation videos and I was so intrigued by not only their transformation, but the skills and stuff they were able to achieve. Like it was totally amazing to me. And I was fascinated because a lot of people, including myself, have never seen something like this done before.
Sure.
Saw them doing muscle ups, one arm pull ups, planche push ups, and rib body, you know. So I thought, why not kill 2 birds in 1 stone, get better at push-ups, be able to do all this crazy strength work and skill moves, and also get a better body in the process. So after that, I became obsessed with it. I started doing a lot of research and I created like my own type of routine. And from there, I adjusted based on my own progress and what I've learned.
And sure.
Then that's how I started sharing stuff too.
Yeah, I was gonna ask that because your journey, you started sharing your own journey quite quickly after you first started.
Mm-hmm.
What made you want to put it out there on the internet and share not only your own progress, but also teaching others? Like what inspired you or made you want to do that?
Gotcha. So one thing about me is that I've always been into sharing what I'm doing on social media. Ever since I was like 12 or 13 years old, I had a YouTube channel where I would share how I play certain video games online, best ways and methods to increase your cash or coins in this game or whatever I was doing, or how to solve a Rubik's Cube, how to get waves in your hair. Like
just general like how-tos and helping people out. Right?
Yeah, just teaching people or showing what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And so when it came to fitness, once I got really, really involved in that, it was literally no different. So I remember I made a beginner home workout routine, just showing what I was doing in my backyard at home.
Yeah, man.
And then from there, I just started sharing more progress and teaching others, and slowly more people kept asking, what about this? What about that?
Yeah,
and I was like, you know, I'm perfect. I'll just keep making videos.
Yeah, right.
So it really all started from the beginning, just always sharing what I'm doing and having like this passion and love of just helping and teaching others.
That's really interesting. Austin's story and progression with that is almost identical to mine.
Mm-hmm.
Before doing Fitness FAQs, I was posting just random, I think it was like parkour videos,
yeah,
pool tricks, just showing some like gaming stuff as well.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there just progressed into the fitness FAQ stuff. So it's just interesting that we both had that, I guess, internal drive to share what we're doing and help other people in the process as a result.
Exactly. And I never knew that, you know, you could build an audience based on doing that stuff, or you could build a business or anything like that. It was just out of just fun.
Yeah.
Like just straight a hobby of just sharing and teaching. But then over time, you know, thousands of people start watching and
it grows into, yeah. Austin, what's your workout routine? How do you get so jacked, bro?
Exactly.
You have to start answering these questions.
You know, so I'm proud of every moment along the way and what I've learned.
That's awesome, man. Mm-hmm. These days, do you find yourself committing much time to learning and education, whether it's in fitness stuff or business? Do you do much reading or research these days?
Oh yeah, I listen to a lot of podcasts. I still read a lot of books.
Good man.
I watch a lot of YouTube videos still I'm subscribed to, even if you post a video, let's say like how to get better at pull-ups. I don't know. I obviously know how to get better at pull-ups, but yeah. I still watch it.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
Just so like if I get like a golden nugget or something that I can learn and implement and potentially teach to somebody else. So I'm always learning, always a student. Always.
That is something that I want everyone watching this to take away. You see Austin and myself, we've built a presence, a business, we've got to a decent level with our calisthenics, but same thing, always learning. You can learn from anyone, mm-hmm. and different fields and apply it to what you're doing.
Exactly.
So it's great that you've got that growth mindset.
Exactly.
With it.
And I was mentioning this to somebody the other day, actually, even though I'm an expert at one thing, at the end of the day, none of us are experts at everything. So
yes,
we always have something to learn, always have something to progress in, even if we are experts in it too. Golden nuggets.
Of course, and it's great that you do that from different fields as well, because mm-hmm. even if it's music, they might be putting out their content a certain way, and you might think, okay, that's a cool way for me to do my Instagram post or my YouTube video. So there's mm-hmm. always something you can be learning like that.
Always, always.
Yeah, man. So I was gonna ask you as well, what are your stats? Just so that people know on my channel, just having a clear height, yeah. weight, how tall are you? Coming from you.
All right. I'm not sure of conversions because
I'll put it up on the screen.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So I'm 5'10.5" to 5'11", which is 1 inch under 6 foot. And right now I'm 160 pounds, which is pretty light for me. Whoa. I usually sit around 170, but I've lost about 8 to 10 pounds in the past month.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you'd be consistently lean all year round, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I always look lean all year round. Yeah. I've never properly bulked or gained weight.
Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. What do you put as the reason for you staying so lean? Like, what do you, is it a nutritional approach? How mm-hmm. do you do it? Because a lot of people watching this would see your physique and your skills and really aspire to achieve that as well.
Yeah.
And in particular, it's that you maintain it.
Yeah.
Because I don't question anyone being able to get to that level of body fat, but maintaining it is another thing. So how do you go about, I guess, having it as a lifestyle? How do you keep it going?
Yeah. For me, there's two things. One, just genetical factors.
Okay.
And two, being conscious of my weight and being aware of it, you know, week by week, month by month. So the first one, genetical factors, I'm naturally a skinny guy.
Okay.
So if I was to stop working out right now, I would be skin and bones.
Yeah, right.
No
yeah.
doubt about it. Yeah,
yeah.
yeah. So with that being said, I have a really high metabolism, so to speak. I need a lot of calories just to maintain my weight.
Yeah.
And also my lifestyle, I'm very active. So
yeah, right.
I prefer stairs, I walk places.
Same thing as me, yeah.
You know,
yeah,
so yeah. stuff like that. And also, number two, being aware and conscious of it month by month. I'm just aware of my food choices. I always have an idea of how many calories I'm eating okay. in the day. And right now, I've been tracking for the past month. So being aware of your food and tracking your weight week by week, day by day, or whatever, helps me stay on track too. And also just looking in the mirror. Like if I notice like I'm getting a little blurry here or there, or you know, I just, instead of getting the milkshake one day,
yeah.
I opt for, you know, a water.
I guess it keeps us honest with what we do, because we're mm-hmm. in front of the camera, video, photo, especially in our case, we become aware very quickly some of the decisions we've been making later nights, eating a bit more with friends, or just getting a bit more complacent with our food choices. We get very aware very quickly, don't we?
Yeah, and as social media fitness people, it's pretty, what's the word I'm looking for? It's we have pressure to stay lean
for
almost.
Sure.
Like, it's our image. So when you have like your business relying on your image, then it's pretty easy to stay lean.
I agree. And especially with the calisthenics stuff, it's all about relative strength. So
exactly.
If we get too sloppy, gain some weight, then not only are we not gonna look as good, which like you said, affects the business, but planche gets harder, everything else gets substantially harder as
exactly.
well.
Exactly. So all that combined in together is how I, and probably you too, stay lean all year long. So
any particular approach in terms of nutrition? Are you a vegan? Are you paleo? Are you, what style of eating would you say that you?
So I'm a picky eater.
Okay.
I've been a picky eater my whole life. I've never tried a vegan diet. I've tried pescatarian, all this other stuff, and fasting, like 24-hour fast and eat, and different methods like that. But at the end of the day, I go back to just my traditional diet style, which is just high protein, moderate fats and carbs, and that's it. It's just keeping aware of my macros.
Aware of the macros. So just like whole foods, would you say?
Yeah, whole foods, exactly, yeah.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah.
So there's no secret, man. There's no secret to getting shredded. Tell me about the magic food that I need to take.
There's no magic food. Just be aware of your calorie intake and expenditure, and drink a lot of water, have enough protein, and train. That's
right.
It.
What would you say would be your advice for people that don't want to track calories? If they're like, it's too much for me.
Intuitive eating. So yeah, I used to be that guy where like I never wanted to track. I thought it would take too long, and it's a, what's the word, nuance?
Yeah, because some people that I've spoken to say it feels like it's becoming too obsessive.
Like a chore, yeah.
Yeah, they feel too restricted with, you know, going out with friends and family. What would you say to those people?
Yeah, so for me, one, you could try intuitive eating.
Los Angeles.
Yeah. Whenever there's an airplane or sirens, I just pause. I just freeze what I'm doing. But in regards to intuitive eating, you could try that, which just, you still have to track, like be tracking your weight and be aware of how you look, but just balance everything. Just exit out the obvious bad foods, fried foods, stuff like that. Eat more of a whole food diet and see if that works for you. But in regards to tracking calories, I find that it has given me more freedom.
Okay.
Because when I'm aware of my calories and how much I'm eating, I'm not hard on myself for what I eat. So I look at my calories and I'm like, okay, I can fit this certain food item into today's portions.
Yep.
Whereas if I wasn't tracking, I would be like, I would feel guilty about eating stuff because I'm kind of unaware of how much I've intake for the day. So I feel like tracking calories has really given me that freedom to really eat what I want, because I follow that if it fits your macros approach.
Good. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, and also I find that I'm on my phone a lot, obviously. So just tracking calories takes me 2 minutes, man.
Yeah, it's not as big of a deal once you get used to it.
Yeah.
And I think that's really good advice, because I think most people should at least track calories, even if it was for a week or something like that, because as you said, you get more of an awareness of what foods are, how much is in a chicken breast, how much is in this, this, and this. So that eventually, if you do want to do intuitive eating, you can do it with a little bit more of a scientific approach, that you actually have awareness of portion sizes and what the calories are involved with that.
Yeah, you can just eyeball it and be like, okay, this is about 550, 30 grams protein, 15 grams carbs, 4 fat, whatever. So I find myself doing that too. Like, I can eyeball food and pretty much guess the macronutrient amount because I've tracked for so long.
Okay.
So I feel like that helps too.
How do you find juggling your training with being in a calorie deficit? Because Austin's currently on a cut. As you said, his weight is a bit lower now, trying to get a little bit leaner with where you're going with it. So what would you say, how do you manage being in a deficit while still training?
Yeah, so right now what I've discovered is that some days I'll have low energy levels, so to speak, which is normal when you're in that caloric restriction. But the way I kind of maintain it is I keep the intensity there. I still do everything the exact same, no matter if I'm feeling tired or whatever. Sometimes I'll lower my volume. So instead of like six sets of four, I'll do like a four sets of five, six, something like that. You know, I'll just lower the volume a little bit, but overall the intensity is still there.
Yes,
all that matters. And then, and also I've noticed that, you know, with bodyweight training, while I'm losing weight, my relative strength has actually gone up a tad bit, whereas my weighted calisthenic strength and my weightlifting strength has gone down a little bit too.
Yes.
So it kind of balances out in a way a little bit. But the main thing I notice is just overall energy levels. But if you have the drive and motivation to go out there and keep it intense and still train, then it's not an issue for me.
And I think that because you have that mindset is why you retain the muscle mass that you do. Mm-hmm. Because we were discussing this the other day that a lot of people will go on a calorie deficit, try and lose weight, get leaner, but they don't tackle their training with the same intensity.
Yeah.
So then once they start to cut, they're not satisfied with what they're left with. Mm-hmm. And the reason is because they're not putting in the work. So they're not trying to train as hard as they can, even though some strength loss is inevitable. What we were talking about the other day is you need to train like you're trying to put on strength.
Exactly. Like, just because you're cutting, don't say, oh, I'm gonna lower the weight, do 15 plus reps, I'm trying to tone up. Like,
don't do that. That's what I was telling Austin was when we were doing our leg session. So it could come up with all these different excuses, like I'm traveling, doing a ton of this, extra fatigue, extra stress. You still got to do your routine and try and progress. Whether he's in a deficit or I'm traveling with a lot on my plate, you've got to have that mindset, and that's what it takes to get the results.
Exactly.
So Austin, what would you say is your proudest calisthenic achievement to date? And just giving us a summary of your bests on all the different skills and strength movements.
Yeah, so I would say my proudest achievements is in regards to like moves I've learned.
Yeah, like weighted calisthenics moves. All that
Yeah. I've gotten really good at the weighted pull-up. So I can pull four plates, like when I'm heavier, for like two clean reps.
So that'd be equivalent to how many pounds?
What is that? 180 pounds.
Solid. That's more than your body weight.
Yeah, nice. 20 pounds heavier than me now. So I've gotten really good at the weighted pull-up and also my body weight pressing strength. Mm-hmm. So 90-degree handstand push-ups. I remember, I think a year and a half ago, I landed a 90-degree press-up clap push-up. Yeah.
That's Instagram worthy, man.
Yeah, it sure is. And I was pretty happy with that.
Nice.
And besides that, just my overall progress in the calisthenics, because I remember looking back at people literally holding handstands, like a basic handstand.
Yeah, right.
And I would tell myself, like, there's no way I'm gonna learn that. Like, how do these people do that?
Yeah.
So I would practice all the time and fall. And then now I can pop a handstand in my sleep.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah, so it's crazy just the progression when you look back about your mindset and how you thought during that time period.
And your own progress and growth with it, as opposed to comparing yourself to someone else's journey.
Exactly, yeah. I tell people that all the time. Like, just because I learned a planche in a year, it might take you 2 years, 3 years, you
exactly.
know?
Exactly. So, how long did it take you to learn the handstand?
Handstand, once I started actually working on it, I was able to hold a decent one, like consistently, I think within 6 months.
6 months?
Yeah.
For how long would you say the average hold?
Average hold was probably like 8 to 12 seconds.
Okay. So there's a ballpark, giving Austin as an example, just so you can have your own reference point. But once again, use your own progress as your motivation to source how far you've gone and where you want to be as well.
Exactly.
What would you say is the hardest move that you've had to acquire?
The hardest move? There's a lot of hard moves in calisthenics, but the ones that I've trained, I would say it's probably a straight leg planche, maybe. Just being able to just hold it with straight arms, legs, with good body alignment.
Yeah.
And one arm handstand. That
Is that what you're still working on?
Yeah, I'm still working on that one. But yeah. For some reason, like, there's so many different moving parts. Like, you gotta, once you reach that level of advancedness, mobility, flexibility plays a role in certain things, and you really gotta look at it as more than just strength training. Like, yes. It's a whole body type of thing now.
It's a different world, hand balancing. It's more of a skill-based practice where mm-hmm. looking at what your training's been for the most part, it'd be more strength, sets and reps, mm-hmm. some basic bodyweight skills of like levers and planches. Exactly. It's not really a coordination-based movement like
exactly.
that. So
yeah.
I feel that with those movements, you really need to dedicate your practice towards it
mm-hmm.
at the expense of other stuff.
Exactly, and that's, I don't think I'm capable or willing of that at this point in time right now.
Yeah.
Because I have other things I want to work on, and I don't want to be training one-arm handstand all the time. So that's my own fault, and maybe I'm aware of that now. Yeah. So, you know.
How do you deal with the downside of calisthenics, which is there's so many things that we can be doing?
Mm-hmm.
How do you deal with knowing that you could be doing all this stuff and choosing what you want to work on?
Yeah, I would say just staying in my own lane and figuring out what do I really want to learn, like figuring out those 3, 4, 5 skill moves that I really, really want to learn and making those a priority and forgetting about everything else.
For sure.
Like, I don't care about Iron Cross. I don't care about Maltese or Mana or anything like that because I'm focusing on my own thing and what I want to get better at. So I appreciate people who can do that stuff.
Of course, yeah.
Double tap on Instagram. But besides that, like, I'm not going to actually go for it, you know?
Yeah, it's smart. You can't mm-hmm. do it all.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. How do you feel about maintenance, the concept of maintenance, in
yeah.
terms of when you get a skill and you want to work on something else? Are you someone that just lets it go, or do you keep up your level with that?
Yeah. Pressure? So how I've done it, and I've actually done that a lot this past year, is simply training it 1 to 2 times a week for just a few sets. And I've noticed that it pretty much maintains itself, given that my body weight is still the same and everything is still there in regards to my body. But yeah, it was pretty easy to maintain. I didn't find an issue with it. I'm not the type of person to just get something and then never train it again.
Good.
I'm always indirectly doing it for something or just doing a few sets here and there. So
I think it'd be such a waste to spend all that time trying to get it and then just letting it go as well.
Mm-hmm.
Just for that one photo or series
exactly.
of videos.
Yeah.
But the good thing is, once you've got a skill, you've of course built those neurological pathways. You've already got the muscle mass to do the skill.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, just doing a few sets is going to retain that ability to be able to do that.
Exactly.
Which is good.
I do find though, for a handstand, I could probably not do a handstand for 3 months and come back and still do one.
Yeah, it's like riding a bike.
Yeah.
You know, forget how to do it.
Yeah. I'm actually going to do a weightlifting challenge where I only lift weights for like a month straight.
Ooh.
Don't do any calisthenics, and I want to see what maintains and what leaves from there.
Yeah, right. It'd be interesting to see you test your major lifts. I'm not sure if you, like, do you usually do bench press or something?
Never, but I have done that before, yeah, in a YouTube video.
What would be cool for you to do before you do that is just to see how far calisthenics has gotten you. So doing a 1 rep max test on your bench press
mm-hmm.
and just seeing purely without practicing the technique, how your planche work and just general calisthenics translates to bench press.
Yeah, a lot of people are interested in that. And from what I've read and from what I've done, There's a small carryover in that aspect.
Of course. You know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but there's always that element of specificity, learning the skill of the exercise.
Mm-hmm.
But you've already got the base built with your strength and your physique, where the good thing is you've had that foundation where you can go on to other stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. So it comes down to that, and also the motor and coordination, all that stuff. But yeah, there's a little bit of a carryover effect. What do you think about the reverse though? Like bench press to like planche work?
I feel, don't back me with any scientific research papers behind this, but I feel it's going to be harder for someone to come from weight training to body weight stuff
mm-hmm.
compared to vice versa.
Yeah, I agree so too.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I just feel that having that intrinsic awareness of your body coordinating your own joints through space will make it easier for you to manipulate other objects like barbells, dumbbells, that mm-hmm. type of thing. I've just seen people have a harder time with weights coming back, like super strong people in powerlifting, even bodybuilders trying calisthenics, you've probably seen the same.
Yeah.
They really struggle with it more than if we were to try bench, overhead press.
Exactly. Yeah, I see that in the gym all the time. Like I can work in with you and your shoulder presses, but come over here and do some handstand push-ups. It's not happening.
That's the beauty of this approach. Would you say that's your philosophy, having calisthenics the base, and then do you supplement your training with other stuff as well?
Yeah, so I consider myself a calisthenics based athlete. So just like somebody could be plant based diet, even though they're not full blown vegan or vegetarian. Most of my training consists of bodyweight training and weighted calisthenics. However, I also supplement it with isolation exercises, and for legs, I do different weighted compounds such as, you know, stiff leg deadlift, RDLs, or calf work, whatever.
So you'd say you're balancing calisthenics with weight training?
I'm doing like a pretty good balance with it.
Okay.
And I find that it helps a lot in regards to imbalances and also just aesthetical reasons too.
What would you say are some of the limitations with just a purely calisthenics approach?
One, I would say legs. So
straight away.
Me at least, for some reason I can do like these different pull-up variations and all that and get a really nice physique and get bigger muscles and stuff like that. But when I do it with legs, yes, I gain muscle, but not to the point where it matches my upper body. So I needed an external load in that sense. And I discovered that a little late, but at least I did discover that. And what was the question? I forgot.
Limitations with calisthenics.
Oh, limitations.
So legs?
Yeah, legs, posterior chain area, just working that stuff. And other limitations. Overall, I would just say imbalances.
Okay.
Just overall imbalances, whether it be legs, like I said, maybe some rear delts, weak points. And also, like if you have small calves, or...
Why does this keep coming up? I'm not asking you about calves, Dad.
No, I've seen the comment so many times, it's like burned in my head.
Austin knows that that's a genetic limitation for him. He's working on it. Just don't go too hard in those comments.
Don't go too hard on me, guys, but...
I bet you the top comment's gonna be, what about those calves?
Exactly, always. Or you need to train your calves, Austin.
Yeah.
But little do they know.
I agree with you, man. In terms of calisthenics limitations, I feel particularly for strength development, legs, it's really hard with body weight because with strength, you need to, of course, use lower reps, which is pretty hard to do with your pistol squats and those type of things. But in terms of building muscle, you can still do it with bodyweight only approach. The only thing is it's pretty brutal. You need to do high reps to get that intensity.
Really, really high volume.
Which, that lactic acid buildup, those metabolic byproducts, it's not a really fun way to train.
Exactly. There's just more, efficient ways of doing it.
It can be done, but it's just, what do you prefer doing? What do you have access to as well?
That too. Like if my gym membership was gone, then I'll be set, I'll be straight, because I know how to train with my body weight.
Exactly.
And I would just do that instead. But if I have access to a gym, then I'm just gonna take the more efficient route.
Nice. How do you use weights to work on weaknesses and limitations for the upper body? Because that's what you said with calisthenics.
Gotcha.
Certain points.
So for what I've discovered is your lateral delt and also upper chest, for me at least. So I do dumbbell side raises. And also, every now and then I would do incline dumbbell bench press. Because I find that the external load really forces development and strength in my upper chest. Because I do so much planche work and dip work. Very, very lower chest heavy. So once I started doing that stuff, that's when my upper body became a lot more balanced.
So you feel from a physique development perspective, if you just did calisthenics, you get good results, but there's certain spots that you kind of need weights to help out.
Yeah, like if when I was just doing bodyweight training, of course you can look amazing, like a Greek god.
Yeah.
But from a once you get to that next level and you really start nitpicking your body, you're like, oh, I need some more upper chest, I need some more lateral delts. So that's when you start doing the different isolation stuff.
Awesome. That's what I wanted to ask you about, that because not many people combine weights and body weight. Mm-hmm. And it's just nice to hear that that's what it takes to really refine your physique to make it look just that little bit more on point.
Exactly.
Nice. Exactly. So after training for a few years with calisthenics based as your main training approach, what would you say has been most effective for building strength the quickest? Be it exercise selection, training frequency, volume. Give us your recommended approach or what's worked best for you.
Yeah, so one, figuring out what exactly you want to build strength in. So do you want to learn the one arm pull up, planche push up, 90-degree handstand push-up, whatever. Figuring that out first, and then picking the exercises that work towards that, that fit your level of strengths. Okay. So, for example, if I wanna learn a planche push-up, I will start doing tuck planche push-ups. And what I've also noticed is that training for a lower amount of reps with a higher set volume and longer rest time, just taking the typical strength approach or powerlifting approach and replicating that with bodyweight training helped me gain strength really, really fast.
I'm glad you said that because a lot of the content I see, especially on YouTube, online, is mainly like circuit-based stuff, endurance-based for bodyweight exercises. And I feel that there's still that lack of knowledge and application that you should apply strength training principles to calisthenics. So I agree with what Austin's saying with, lower reps for strength, lower duration holds for strength for your skills, and higher sets, longer rest periods.
Exactly. Perfect. Just doing it as much as you can, as fresh as you can, and just replicating that in your training. That's why I came up with this, you know, bodyweight bodybuilder type of terminology. And what that really means is just replicating bodybuilding principles or what's popular in that space with just bodyweight training. You know, we don't have to make it fancy. We don't have to do these crazy circuits or anything like that. Because the real way that you gain muscle and gain strength is just through repetition.
So. Through repetition, progressive overload, getting stronger on the basic movements.
Exactly.
But also, your approach isn't just about strength. You said that you were doing some bodybuilding stuff as well. You wouldn't just stop with strength, right? So in your routine, you'd be doing, would you do strength stuff first, followed by more work, or how do you do it?
Yeah, so the way I structure my programs is that I do skill training in the first block, or warm-up skill training, and then strength training, so the heavy compound-based movements. And then after that, isolational stuff and cardio if I do that.
Perfect. Because I think with calisthenics, you get people doing either or. So your approach very similar to mine, where I prioritize skills and strength and then like to finish with some more hypertrophy based stuff.
Exactly.
So yeah, combine, you can combine the two definitely into your routine.
Yeah, at first I did not do that. I was really strength only. I just want to get really, really strong. So I would focus on warm up, skill training, and then just strength work, and then call it a day and call it a workout.
Okay.
But over time, that's when I started, you know, throwing in, you know, calf raises, lateral raises,
you
know, upper chest, whatever, so stuff like that.
And I'm sure you'd at times be getting questions regarding, are you natural? Do you take steroids?
All the time.
I have to ask the question for the people. Yeah. What's your thoughts on this topic? Are you natural?
Yeah. So one, yes, I am natural. I've never taken steroids in my life. Promise to the Lord himself. And like my take on it?
Yeah, what's your take on people that do?
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on the topic in general, steroids?
Yeah, so I have done research on steroids. Like I've not looked into it for me to use, but I've just done research on it, learned more about it.
Just have a general awareness.
Yeah, awareness of it. And I feel like people who use it do it for like a purpose, like whether they want to compete at a really, really high level. And, you know, these mass monsters these days, they look absolutely insane.
Yeah.
And if that's what they want to do, then by all means, go for it. But for me and how I train and what I do, it makes no sense. Like, why would I try and add on even more muscle to myself that is going to be essentially useless for me in my calisthenics work too.
And I mean, if you look at it this way, if you've been training for at least 3 years, you've built some muscle, got some strength, man, you're better than 99% of the population.
Like, exactly.
Going that extra step, you see people's reasons for doing it, but if you just look at it really objectively, you're so much better than most people, and you're happy with yourself, or you should be in that respect.
And I look at it as a video game almost. So let's say you're playing a video game and you're really good, but you come across some cheat code that allows you to make it to the next level like that. For me, I wouldn't even take that cheat code because the game is just so fun to me. And I enjoyed the process of getting to that next level.
And there's something really gratifying about just doing it all off your own work ethic, nutrition, recovery, progress over time.
Yeah.
That feeling's quite good.
Plus the negative health risks that you would get from that, and also how it's temporary.
Yeah.
Like, it just makes no sense to me, and I don't understand how people could think I would ever do that.
But that's good, yeah. And I think that comes with the maturity of just living. Like, after a while, you realize that there's always a consequence for some decision or action that you make. So
yeah,
you can get great results quickly, you can look like a beast, perform well, recover well, but we probably don't have enough research on the long-term consequences to know for sure.
And I don't care to know or want to know
either, exactly. And I think as well, if you're making programs for the general public, it makes sense that you're in the same environment internally as other people.
Yeah.
Because if you're teaching people how to build muscle, get stronger with calisthenics, and you're taking drugs, but you're selling programs to people that aren't, it's almost useless, isn't it? Because your recommendation for sets, reps would be completely different.
Yeah, exactly.
Because from the research that I've done on the topic, it's a completely different playing field in terms of how long you're, you know, building muscle for.
How long you recover everything.
Muscle protein synthesis.
It's a literal cheat code.
Yeah.
So I'd rather learn the best way, which is the natural way.
You can kind of tell too with the person's approach to training if they're just doing super high reps. That's all they do. If they're not that strong, but they look like a freak, then chances are that they might be taking drugs.
Exactly.
If someone's natural and they're strong, generally it relates pretty closely.
Yeah. I agree too.
What I've seen. And in terms of, just say the average person watching this, maybe they're a personal trainer, fitness enthusiast, or they're just interested in developing their own business or brand.
Yeah.
What would be your best advice for growing a social media following?
Gotcha. So my very, very best advice would be, one, to post content. One, also do not overthink posting that content.
Yeah.
Just do it. You don't have to have the best camera or anything. As long as you're giving value to the audience that you wanna educate or help, then do that. And YouTube is a great way to do that.
Yep.
And also targeting the beginner niche and whatever you're an expert at does really, really well too. So example, calisthenics, making videos more targeted towards, you know, the basics and how a beginner can build the reps up. Those videos will do very, very well because the beginner niche is absolutely massive and it's ever growing. Like, somebody today wants to learn calisthenics, so they're gonna go on YouTube and search how to find how to do it. So post content, don't overthink it, and aim for that beginner niche and keep doing it. Consistency wins.
So we're gonna wrap this video up now. Finished talking to Austin, answered a ton of questions. We got a real good insight into where you're at with your own training and your business as well.
Yeah,
it was nice chatting to you, man. I'll put all your social media links up on the channel.
Appreciate it. Thank you for having me, man. We had a great talk and very insightful for everybody. I'm glad that you brought me on. Thank you.
No worries, man.
Awesome. Sweet. Hands are sweaty. It's hot in here.
Sweet, man. Till next time.
See ya.